Hi, my name's Ant Surrage. I'm a technical development manager here at Fargro, and today is the next in the video series on Taegro. So we're going to be focusing specifically on the product itself in this video. If you haven't watched the first in the series, which featured Dan from Syngenta, where we get a bit of an overview on Syngenta in the UK, as well as my colleague Stuart, who looked at the key diseases that Taegro would control, then please do go give that a watch. It will set a bit more of a scene for the following presentation. But in this specific presentation, we're going to look at the product itself, what's in it, how it works, some technical detail on the product to give you a bit more understanding on Taegro itself. So, as a bit of an overview on the product, Taegro is a microorganism-based fungicide, which is formulated as a wettable powder. It contains the bacteria Bacillus amyloliquefaciens. The reason why I reference it's a bacteria there is often bacteria can have a few strengths over fungal biopesticides, so bacteria tend to be more resilient in the environment and tend to be able to be tank mixed slightly more readily than some of the fungal based biopesticides. So Taegro is labelled for the suppression of diseases on cucurbits, solanaceae, lettuce and strawberry in permanent protection with full enclosure, as well as field grown crops of grapevine. So there are some EMUs, which are extension of authorisations for minor uses that we at Fargro are working on, but at the time of recording those are yet to come through, but we will keep you of course informed as and when we get those through to broaden the uses of Taegro. So how does Taegro work? So Taegro has multiple modes of action, which is really useful from a point of view of resistance management, but also in terms of getting better control of diseases, having multiple ways in which you can attack them is of course beneficial. So if we look at the first key mode of action, that is the induction of ISR and SAR, so induced systemic resistance and systemically acquired resistance, which are genetic pathways inside the plant that upregulate certain genes that code for proteins that give defense against incoming pathogens. The production of antimicrobial metabolites, so these are metabolites that have antifungal properties that can actively push back against the incoming diseases, and the competition for space and nutrients. So there's two modes of action, if you like, which are external to the plant, the production of the antimicrobial metabolites and the competition for space and nutrients, and one that is internal in the upregulation of genetic pathways. The two that are external complement each other really nicely. So if you think about it in terms of colonizing an area but then also pushing back against the disease, those two work really nicely in tandem, and we'll touch on that in a bit more detail later on in the presentation. Okay, so if we look at a bit more detail on those modes of action, to start with, we look at the production of antimicrobial metabolites. Taegro's genome contains 9 giant clusters, which are directed for synthesizing lipopeptides and polyketides. And what these do is they have an antimicrobial and antifungal properties, which actively push back against incoming pathogens. So Taegro produces 3 really key ones, surfactin, itarin, and fengocyanin. And when these are on the leaf, these will just help push back, which we'll see demonstrated on a Petri dish slide slightly later on. So, when do we get these antimicrobial metabolites being produced? Well, they are produced at each stage of division during mitosis. So you have the single cell, it then undergoes division, and then once you have 2 cells, those 2 cells then undergo division. So you have this exponential growth in the cells. And at each of these division stages, that is when these antimicrobial metabolites are released. So as Taegro develops and starts to divide more and more, you start getting more and more of these compounds. Taegro, when formulated in the packet, is a wettable powder. So it is benign like that, which gives it some good shelf life, which we'll look at later on. But as soon as Taegro is mixed, the endospores find themselves in a favourable environment, and that is when that division starts to take place. So as soon as you start mixing the Taegro, you do start to get this division of the cells and those antimicrobial metabolites being produced, which can be really useful when applied, because that means straight away when Taegro is on the leaf surface, there's some of those antimicrobial metabolites which are actively pushing back against key diseases. And so this is a slide that I mentioned earlier. What it looks like in terms of these antimicrobial metabolites working can be visualized quite nicely on a petri dish. So in this case, we have pathogens growing freely. On the left-hand side there, you have botrytis, alternaria, a few diseases on there growing on a petri dish. And you see them just spreading out, developing, moving across the agar to take up more space. However, when you compare that to a petri dish with the same pathogens on with a Taegro strip, cutting it into thirds, you can see that the diseases are almost being pushed back. And that's those antimicrobial metabolites being formed, pushing the pathogen back into the corners. And you can think how useful that would be on the leaf surface when you have the colonization of Taegro, but then also these metabolites pushing back, actively defending from further growth of the pathogen up the leaf. So Taegro is applied, the metabolites are then produced at the cell division stages, and that pushes back against the fungus. So the next mode of action taking place outside of the plant is the competition on the leaf surface. So you can see here we have a petri dish that's had a leaf stamp that hasn't been treated by Taegro on the left hand side. So there's some development there of some fungus on the petri dish, and then on the right hand side a leaf that has been colonized by Taegro. And what you can see is there's a lot of those Taegro spores there that are taking up a lot of the agar in the petri dish. And if you think about that from the point of view of a pathogen coming onto a leaf, on that leaf that's been treated by Taegro, there's far less available space. So the pathogen is going to be outcompeted by the Taegro. And if you tie that back into the previous mode of action we just spoke about, even if the pathogen were to find a small area where Taegro has yet to colonize, Taegro producing those antimicrobial metabolites would help keep that pathogen just there in that space so that it doesn't spread further throughout the crop. So the third and final mode of action is taking place inside the plant itself, and that is the upregulation of genetic pathways that are giving you defense against incoming pathogens. So how do we know that this is happening inside the plant? Well, we have a untreated control plant, a plant that's been treated by Taegro. There is then a mimicked pathogen attack using hydrogen peroxide. Sampling is then taken of the plant tissue that can then undergo RNA extraction to quantify the different genes that are being upregulated to see if there is a significant difference in the upregulation of those genes. So in this case, two key gene pathways have been pulled out, the PR2 pathway and PR8. So PR stands for pathogenosis related, and these are pathways that are related to the induction of different systems that give plants defense against incoming diseases. So the fact that PR2 was upregulated 27 times more than the untreated and PR8 23 times more than the untreated, that as those pathways have been shown to be involved in the defense against biotic and abiotic stress, which means that the plant, once those are upregulated, will have greater resistance to those stressors. The sort of actual physical changes that we see from that genetic induction is stuff like strengthening of cell walls, strengthening of the leaf cuticle, the production of antimicrobial metabolites, all aiding the defense of the plant against incoming pathogens. So moving on from the mode of action, if we look at some other key technical points on Taegro, as mentioned earlier in the presentation, Taegro is a really good partner to use in a resistance management program to take the pressure off single site inhibitors or products that you might be using really consistently. There is FRAC guidelines. So FRAC is the Fungicide Resistance Action Committee. So they publish a table with all the different products that are available in the UK split into different categories. And what growers must do is rotate between those categories to ensure that there's different modes of action that are taking place. Because although you might be using different products, it's entirely possible that the chemistry within them is acting on the same site, which would mean that that is under pressure for resistance. So under the old FRAC guidelines, Taegro was FRAC code 44, which is the induction of host plant defense mechanisms, which we've just touched on in the previous slide. But under the new FRAC guidelines, Taegro falls into BM2, which is biological mode of action 2. And that has a lot of various different modes of action in it, including the induction of defense genes, but also stuff like competition for space and nutrients and the production of antimicrobial metabolites. So what FRAC have done is realised that these products don't just work in one way, they work in multiple ways, hence why it's changed in its coding. So one point that's really key about Taegro is its longevity on the leaf. So there's a lot of biopesticides that, if used at an incorrect time, won't last particularly long on the leaf. They tend to need the disease there that they're going to infect to keep multiplying. But Taegro, once it's been applied, you see that initial drop in concentration because obviously the formulated product is quite concentrated, but then it plateaus and then you get an increase in vegetative spores and then it drops away again. And that time period, in that case, in glasshouse lettuce, is over the course of 18 days. Now, yes, of course, it's going to be variable between crops and what type of growing environment you're working in, the quality of the glass, or even if you're outside in viticulture situations where UV is going to be higher, that is going to be detrimental. It's going to last less long. But compared to other biopesticides, the concept is still solid that this is going to last relatively long on the leaf, which gives you a wider spray spray window to get efficacy. So if you're using GDH modelling, growing degree hour modelling to predict when you're at risk of certain diseases, if you use a product like Taegro, you have that greater window within the model for there to be efficacy. So this image here is kind of similar to the one we looked at earlier with the Petri dish. We're looking there under a scanning electron microscope at Taegro cells lying and multiplying on the leaf surface. So that's what the leaf surface looks like. And you can just imagine for an incoming pathogen spore with all those different Taegro cells there, there's not much space that they're going to be able to reside in. There's going to be competition there, as well as the production of those antimicrobial metabolites pushing them back. So it's a harder environment in which for the pathogen to succeed. Another really key strength of bacterially based biopesticides is their ability to operate at a wider range of environmental conditions. So Bacillus amino liquefaciens are ubiquitous in the environment and survive at a lot of conditions. So the optimum temperature is somewhere between that sort of 30 to 35 marks, so relatively warm, but it does start having efficacy and start multiplying above 15 degrees. Now, lower than 15 degrees, there will still be some activity, but it's not going to be particularly efficacious. Those lower temperatures aren't really an issue. Once it warms back up again, the bacteria will get going again and they'll start thriving. The higher end is where we start running into issues. So the product will work up to 45 degrees. If you start going above that, you're going to denature the bacteria. However, in practice, that's extremely unlikely to happen. If you start getting those temperatures in your crop, then you've probably got bigger things to worry about than the efficacy of your biopesticides. So a really good temperature range. pH compatibility is good, a wide range that it works at, and that's obviously key for different water qualities across the UK, but also key in terms of tank mixing. So we at Fargro publish tank mix lists inside our technical notes, so please do get in contact if you'd like the full list of tank mix products for Taegro. So just to quickly touch on the storage stability of Taegro, I think this is quite key to touch on because there's often issues with biopesticides that they need certain storage requirements or the storage time isn't very long. Because it's bacterially based, again, the shelf life is good. There's a couple of graphs there showing it lasting over 34 weeks. So you check the product label for the up-to-date shelf life. But it's not one that requires much management in terms of stock rotation. So what's really key with our biopesticides that we're applying to the crop is that they're not going to have an effect on our macrobiological populations. So macrobiological controls being biological controls that are applied to the crop, so bugs that eat other bugs or parasitic wasps and so forth. What we don't want to do is build up a population of these and then come in with a product and spray and then kill them. So Taegro has been undergoing trials compared to other products, as well as independent trials looking at the effects on macrobiological populations. And statistically, Taegro was proving harmless to adults, and then also being proved to be harmless to nymphs as well. So what's important to remember is that you need to integrate this into an IPM program. And this will not have an effect on your macrobiological controls greater than the effect of water. If you think about it logically, as mentioned in the previous slides, you know, bacillus species are present in the environment, so it would make sense that they're not going to have a detrimental effect on beneficial insects. What some people might be thinking is, you know, bacillus amyloliquefaciens, bacilluses, there's a bacillus thuringiensis, which of course is a control for caterpillars, but bacillus species are very different across the board, and amyloliquefaciens is not one that has any insecticidal activity, so there's no need to worry about the effects that bacillus amyloliquefaciens as Taegro will have on your beneficial insects. So just to briefly touch on some key technical details on Taegro, its active ingredient is bacillus amyloliquefaciens, a specific strain FZB24. It comes as a wettable powder formulation, with the application method being a foliar spray. The dose rate is 370 grams per hectare with a 1 day harvest interval. So the key diseases that Taegro has efficacy on is powdery mildew on cucurbits, downy mildew on lettuce, powdery mildew and early blight on solanaceae crops, grey mould on strawberry, and grey mould and powdery mildew on grapevine. So quite a wide range of diseases there. So it's worthwhile checking the label as well as using the Fargro technical notes to see exactly what it's advised for your specific crop, as well as seeing stuff like the spray intervals and so forth. So to finish off, just a quick summary of the technical details. So Taegro offers broad spectrum disease suppression, compatible with a range of chemical pesticides, so very promising partner in a disease management program. Again, please do check out the Fargro technical notes for the list of tank mix compatible products that we have for Taegro. Benign environmental profile and harmless to beneficial insects and pollinators, so really good from an environmental and sustainability point of view, as well as the ability to mix it into your IPM program. A short pre-harvest interval with no risk of chemical residues being left, exempt from MRL classifications, so really useful in a spray program from that perspective. Very low risk of resistance potential, so very good for managing resistance in the crop. So again, think back to those slides looking at the FRAC codes, a really good one to integrate in to reduce down the pressure of resistance. And no phytotoxicity issues observed in any of the trials, so very good from a crop safety point of view. So that concludes my presentation for today. Thank you for taking the time to watch the video. My contact details are there on screen if you want to get in contact to learn more about the product or anything else that Fargro does. There will be a third video in this series of Taegro videos that will be featuring myself and Dr. Joshua Bernstone, where we will be discussing biopesticides such as Taegro and also the state of play for biopesticides more generally. So I look forward to seeing you tune in there.